Last time we learned that to write an account of a great Mediterranean person's childhood required no research, no fact-checking, and no reliable sources in the modern sense. Thus, the evangelists we name Matthew and Luke wouldn't have needed to interview Jesus' parents, or home village, or childhood friends and acquaintances. We discussed how, according to scholars Bruce Molina and Richard Rohrbaugh, almost all the information gospel writers needed for this task could be solidly inferred from Jesus' adult behavior. This was because they, like every ancient person, knew that a great adult must have been great in miniature as a child. So to answer the riddle, how did Matthew and Luke discover the baby Jesus, is understanding how they explored regularly and routinely the adult risen Jesus appearing in visions before them in the Jesus group. Being inspired by God does not transform ancient Mediterranean scribes into 21st century idealized American news reporters. The most important part of the word inspiration is the prefix in. Inspiration happens in history, and in a cultural setting. Imagine that you were an author living long ago in the Mediterranean world. You belong to a culture that has no awareness of human psychological development from children growing to adults. Additionally, you were socialized to believe that children were adults in miniature. And so if you knew of a great heroic adult, whatever heroic or great qualities he had as an adult must have also been present in the same person when he was a child. Now imagine you wrote an account of the hero's infancy and childhood. Why would you need to suddenly morph into a 21st century American journalist or biographer in order to accomplish your task? If you are an ancient Mediterranean storyteller, about 95 to 99% of the information you need will be provided by your image of the adult hero. Then, trained in the art of ancient Mediterranean rhetoric, you will craft an honorable childhood account that mirrors the hero as you know and interpret him in his adult form. If you are a late 1st century Jesus group author writing about Jesus' childhood, about 5 to 1% of your data will come from embarrassing stuff. This would be material passed down through the Jesus group and from its enemies, stuff neither yourself nor the Jesus tradition would ever invent. Examples would be like his lowly village peasant status, or that Jesus was a starving artisan and day laborer, or the embarrassing fact that he comes from Nazareth in Galilee, nothing place of nothing people. Remember how in the fourth gospel that Nathanael recalls that nothing good comes from Nazareth? Why would gospel authors invent scandals like those? Answer, they wouldn't. None of it squared with the great hero appearing before them in visions, the Messiah and cosmic Lord, soon to return from Skyvault with power to establish theocracy in the land of Israel. But both insiders and outsiders to the Jesus groups remembered that Jesus was called Jesus of Nazareth. The authors of the Gospels couldn't dodge that embarrassment or the other scandals remembered. They were forced to face these facts, and they did so creatively. But their creative responses were not the stuff of bullshit artists or used car salespeople. They were honestly grappling with how the risen Lord they experienced as risen could possibly have come from such shameful, lowly origins. So they wrote truth from truth, folks. Factual truths, remember, are only one type of truth. Truth is a much wider circle, encompassing factual truths. So, Jesus' mother being shamefully pregnant before living with her husband? Paul never talks about this. After Paul, the earliest gospel, Mark, completely omits any infancy stories. If he knew what Matthew and Luke describe about the wondrous birth of Jesus, how could Mark possibly have left that out? But like later evangelists, the anonymous scribe we call Mark nevertheless heard the slander of the gossip network. Some people consider Jesus to be a bastard. Note the culturally unusual expression "son of Mary" in Mark chapter 6, verse 3. That isn't how you identify somebody in the biblical world. It's the son of the father, not the son of the mother. Unless you don't know who the father is, you're not sure who the father is, then you might say "son of Mary." See? Mark, writing around 70 Common Era and no earlier than 65 Common Era, refers to Jesus the tecton, or artisan. But he never mentions any human father. and other than Joseph of Arimathea, names no other character Joseph. According to context group scholar Andres van Aard, from 70 till 135 Common Era, controversies about peasant Jesus' illegitimacy raged between the Jesus groups and their fellow Israelites outside the Jesus groups. At this time, we learn about Joseph. Writing in the 80s, Matthew tells of Joseph's righteousness and his Davidic honor. Matthew draws heavily from the Joseph we find in the book of Genesis. Matthew's Joseph, therefore, also has prophetic dreams. He is described as a hero taking a holy marriage with an impure wife. Aided by God, this Joseph saves his family by taking them into Egypt. Now Luke writes after Matthew, and he's oblivious to many of the details Matthew includes, like the Holy Family ever going into Egypt, or King Herod and his plot to murder newborns. Luke doesn't mention any of that. He instead reports Joseph taking his family on a journey to the temple in Jerusalem. No document written before 70 Common Era mentions Joseph. After the 2nd century, literature augments this figure, sometimes into the bizarre. How much of these so-called facts about Joseph correspond with the historical situation of Jesus? Did any human father play a role in the life of the historical Jesus? These are important questions to ask in this year of Joseph. When writing about great Mediterranean heroes, whatever outstanding characteristics he enjoyed as an adult simply must have been there from birth. They would have remained constant throughout his entire life. That is how ancient Mediterraneans perceived, understood, and communicated human maturation. The unknown anonymous evangelists we call Matthew and Luke were no different. Early Jesus groups believed that the hero Jesus of Nazareth was the Messiah and cosmic Lord, soon to come from God with power. Since they recognized this tremendous significance in the adult Jesus, they realized that it must also have belonged to the infant Jesus. Consequently, it was evident to the Jesus groups that the birth and childhood of this hero had to be exactly like Matthew and Luke described it. So Matthew chapter 1 and 2 and Luke chapter 1 and 2, even though they have major biographical disagreements and contradict each other, are nevertheless both true. They bring out the truth of Jesus. But American Christian heads explode upon learning all this because our society fails to distinguish truth from factual truths. Hence our unfair demand that truth always be packaged as Western people present it. Do you know why we do this? Maybe it is because, starved of mythology and blocking access to panhuman encounters with God in altered states of consciousness experiences, we American Christians are really just a bunch of scratch-off atheists. I'm not talking about the rare type of deep, mystical atheist who is full of empathy for the world. No, I'm talking about silly atheists. Starving to death without healing or meaning, we scratch-off atheists arrogantly think ourselves the center of the universe, and that everyone in every age and culture should think just like us and tell stories after our own perfect pattern for telling stories. How's that working out for us this year? Merry Christmas, indeed.